Hello, and welcome to Life Transforming Ministries live stream. Thanks so much for joining us today. Right now, we are streaming live on both Facebook and YouTube, so please like and subscribe. But because of reasons unknown, those channels just don't always play nice. So for the absolute best experience, we encourage you to enjoy LTM one of two ways. Number one, in person at 6500 Wyngard Road in Orlando, Florida, just around the corner from the Florida Mall. Trust me, there's nothing like being in the house. Or on our website, go to ltmorlando.org/live for a smooth, uninterrupted stream of our live service. So go ahead, if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, head on over to ltmorlando.org/live. It'll be great. And when you get there, hit the button underneath the video and claim a free gift just for joining us. Thanks again for being here with us today, and I think you're really going to enjoy today's message. Now, let's jump into our live service.
Hello, hello. Welcome to Life Transforming Ministries. Hallelujah. Laughter does the heart good like a medicine. Hallelujah. Welcome to Life Transforming Ministries. On behalf of Pastor Nick and myself, to all of you that who are online, welcome, welcome, welcome. We're so glad that you're joining us tonight. I just know you're going to be blessed as always. Hallelujah. 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 God gives us some awesome words around here for our life. Amen. So we can win. Yeah. At this time, we're going to do our confession of faith. Repeat after me. I came to receive from God. The devil can't stop it. He can't block it. For greater is he that lives in me than he who lives in the world. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Repeat after me. I thank you, Father, that I walk by faith and not by sight. My faith works by love. Faith is guiding my free will to please God. Every day and every way, I contend for the faith. I walk in the victory that overcomes the world. That is my faith. My faith does not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the word of God. I trust, rely, and have full confidence in the promises of God. I'm firmly convinced of your truths. I am persuaded that the word works for me. I am persuaded that God is on my side. I am persuaded that God is all the while at work in me. I thank you, Father, that I am saved. I submit myself to your righteousness and receive vital and correct knowledge from your word so that I do what I ought to do. I believe the impossible and I receive the incredible. Because I'm firmly convinced that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. At this time, you may greet your neighbor and take your seats. If we have any first-time visitors with us tonight, I ask that you stand, tell us your name, and how you found out about the church. Okay. If you're online for the first time, welcome once again. There's a comic section. In that comic section type, I'm new. A link will appear there. Click on it. Fill that out because we want to be a blessing to you tonight for joining us. Amen? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You guys ready to start our service for tonight? Hallelujah. Our last service pastor talked about the power and the benefits of a selfless spirit. Tonight we talk about the cutworm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then we'll soar into what we've heard. Amen. Praise team, come forth. Stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Bible tells us to enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Enter to his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Let's bless his name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let's bless his name. Let's shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's so good. He's so worthy. God, we thank you. We thank you for waking us up this morning, Lord. In our right minds, God, we thank you. Hallelujah. His word says that everything that has breath, praise the Lord.
When I move my mouth.
lifted high. Strongholds are coming down, and Jesus is lifted high. Strongholds are coming down. Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus is lifted high.
Strongholds are coming down.
Strongholds are coming down.
And Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high.
Always lifted high in this place.
Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high.
He's lifted high in our lives.
Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high.
He's lifted higher and higher and higher.
Jesus is lifted high.
Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. Jesus is lifted high. The shout hallelujah. He's lifted high in this place.
Hallelujah. Let's continue to lift the name of Jesus on high. Hallelujah.
Being our light and our salvation, Lord. We thank you for always being with us, Father.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Give him glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Just worship him. It's all about him. You're faithful, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord. Your mercy never failed me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
You have. guys welcome our pastor, Pastor Nick.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Y'all don't have to change. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory.
Praise.
Ain't God good?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Give God another shout, hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, glory, glory. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we thank you for this night. We thank you, Father, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that revelation knowledge shall flow freely tonight. Uninterrupted and unhindered by any satanic or demonic force. Thoughts that go against your word, Lord, I bind them in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for Jesus. I thank you for forgiveness. I thank you for his selfless love towards us, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that tonight you'll use me whichever way you see fit. Lord, I pray none of me and all of you. It's in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Give God some praise.
Hallelujah.
Hug somebody next to you. You may be seated. Amen.
Hallelujah.
I guess the kids could just stay in today. Kai, you want to stay in here with Pastor Nick today? Yeah, you do? Come on, big man. Come on. You want to stay with Pastor Nick, with Dad? Hang out with the big guys? Oh, my God. All right. You know, I need you. What if I told you I need you in here tonight? You good? All right, man, that's my boy. Amen. So I want to talk tonight. So we've been talking and we've been teaching. And I see tonight, I guess tonight's the first night of school, so a lot of folks had to get their kids ready and all of that kind of stuff. We haven't had a Wednesday night this late in a long time. Amen. Hallelujah. But that's okay. Because we'll teach this tonight and we'll teach it when Sunday. Because we need to hear this probably three or four times. Tonight I want to, you know, we've been talking about the power and the benefits of selfless love.
Yes,
of selfless love, being selfless, how great Jesus was in being so selfless to love us even when we were unlovable, unworthy, all those things. You know, we talked about personal growth and knowledge won't suffice. You know, when it comes to personal growth, knowledge alone won't suffice. True development and transformation requires a godly word-based approach that connects our hearts with our thinker. Our hearts with our thinker. You know, we all got thinkers. We all, you know, we all think we know, right? But the question is our thinker connected to our hearts, right? And then on Sunday, we talked about the benefits of knowing God's unconditional love. And we talked about how, you know, when you get into selflessness and when you really start to understand God's love. Who's in the back? Is my wife in the back? Oh, no, tell them they can stay back there. I'll send the kids back there. Are they back there? Y'all can go back there, guys. Go ahead, Kai. They can go back there. Let them go. That's fine. I didn't know they were back there. I just forgot to dismiss them. So I was going to have them stay in here, man. They gave me a look like, oh, my God. We got to stay and listen to Pastor. So I began to talk on Sunday about these benefits, right? And, you know, we talked about how you will begin to receive the reality of spiritual security. You know, I think that insecurity is like a plague right now. And it's only natural because selfishness is like a plague right now, right? So if it's all about us, if it's all about you, if it's all about, you know, then it's pretty obvious that you would be kind of insecure, right? We talked about becoming righteous conscious, right? Meaning that we don't focus on only what we do, but we come to the real reality of what Jesus did for us, right? And then we talked about walking in fearless living and how fear is so gripping and how it overtakes us, right? And how it can control our lives. Fear of being wrong, fear of being viewed as weak, fear of not succeeding. Fear of not succeeding. Fear of watch this, being found out. So many people fear being found out. Fear that people are going to find out, you know, I got a little bit of fraud to me. You know, I'm a fraud. I've been, you know, all of that you see is a shell, right? It's cover. It's not who I really am. I'm really a whole different person than you think I am. So you walk around fearful that people, you know, are going to find that out. We talked about the condemnation mentality, that you walk around being, you know, feeling condemned. You walk around feeling like, you know, walking on eggshells with God and your relationship with God. Condemnation literally takes you mentally captive. You always walk around like that. Feelings of inferiority. Feelings that you're not good enough. Feelings that you're not adequate. You don't measure up. As a man, as a woman, as a whatever your position is at work, you don't measure up when it comes to getting the job that you want to get or where you want to go, right? It happens. It happens. And then we talked about how peace and joy need to become part of your wardrobe that you put on every day, making a decision to operate in peace and joy. So these were the things that we talked about, you know, all these great benefits of knowing, you know, and operating in the power of selflessness. I think we did a really good job over the last couple of sessions and sermons of going through that and really kind of, right, Jay, drilling that home. But what I want to tell you tonight is that strife and the cutworm are the evidence of an ungodly spirit. I have to be careful when I teach this and when I say this, because I'm not, the intention of the Holy Spirit is not to bring anybody into condemnation. Some of you need some strong conviction. Some of us need some strong conviction because we are set in our marriages, in the church, at work, with our kids. We are set. Set to want to have our way. We are blind to want to have our way. I'll tell you one area with our children. We are the fools that believe that somehow we still control our grown children. I say our children. I'm talking about our grown children out of the house. You still want to lord over their life and get offended when they don't do everything you tell them. Just how my wife and I talk about that, you know, we got some grown children. She ain't in here. We got some hard-headed grown children too. Right? You got to know your children.
Amen.
We got to think of something different to call them, Leroy, besides children.
Yes, sir.
I don't know, Miss Mills. We got to come up with a word. I don't like to say adult child neither. But we got to think of something different. I don't like young adult. No, I don't like none of that. Yeah, offspring, man. Now it sounds like we getting scientific. Anyway, I'm talking about the kids that are out of the house.
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about Isaiah, DJ, Daniel, right? I'm talking about Athena, Asia. I'm not talking about Donovan. I'm talking about the kids that are grown up and they're gone. Not the ones that are still holding on. I'm not talking about the boomerangers, right? Amen. Nick, still hanging in there, right? But even in them, we have to learn to love them unconditionally where they're at. Love them when they're wrong. Love them. Don't just love them when they're doing what we want, the way we want them to do it, how we want. Man, I'm telling you, man, I have helped my wife really see something with this thing. Because her and I are totally at the opposite sides of the spectrum. Now, she's not as bad as some people I know. Right? My wife will let them reap what they sow. That's one good thing about her. Amen? But I'm a whole different way. I'm good with them wherever they're at. I mean, my wife used to be amazed with that, right, friend? But how I would just be good with them wherever they're at. I'm good. I remember when Dean and I, one time, he called me down to Fort Lauderdale. And, man, he was frazzled. He was frazzled, man. And, you know, we get in the car, and I drove all the way down to Fort Lauderdale to see him. I'm like, what's up, man? He's like, it's my son, Daniel. I think it was Daniel, the oldest one. Who's the oldest one?
Daniel.
I'm like, yeah. He said, he kissed a girl. And I looked at Dean. I'm like, I hope so. But he was like 13, right, or something. He was real, real young. But Dean was, he got realized Dean was very religious. Even though he wasn't in the Catholic Church, Dean was about them rules now. I mean, he, right, about them rules. And, man, I had a talk with Dean. And, man, it just freed him. I mean, I'm like, Dean, let me give you a couple others, because mine were a little bit ahead of you, right? Because we went through the Athena thing. Yeah. So I had just come through some of this stuff that he was getting ready to. I said, so, you know, when you catch one of them smoking a cigarette, one of them tells you they smoked a joint. I mean, these are all things that are going to happen. Things, and I'm not trying to prophesy negativity over nobody's kids. I'm just telling you that we got to let our children know at that age that we're going to be there for them, and ostracize them, excommunicate them from the family, you know, and all that kind of stuff that us Christians do. Because Christians are good at killing their own.
Right.
We are the ultimate warriors of killing our own. We will take you out back behind the tent chip and cut you up and hang you out to dry. And let me tell you, man, people, I was telling, I don't know who, if I told the leadership team about Chip's son that just recently got married. You know, his fiance wasn't born again when we started the marriage counseling process. And if y'all ever heard the way Pastor Nick does a wedding, it is by the word, right? I mean, it is, if you're not born again while I'm doing that, it's going to be a little bit of a problem, right? Chip, you heard all the words, right? So everybody was worried, but I wasn't worried. I believed by faith that there was no way she was going to get all that word and truly understand the true love of God and not want that in her life. But my thing to everybody was, we cannot push this on her, make her do it. I had a talk with CJ about it. Don't do that. That'd be the bad way to start. And it took me back, Chip, on what we did and the blessing I told everybody about demonstrating God's unconditional love with this young lady. I had a CEO I worked with at Voxgen about 15 years ago. And I remember when I was leaving London right before he was going to hire me, and he told me why he couldn't hire me, why he was going to pass on me. He said, man, I love everything about you. You spent a week with us. There's no doubt that you could turn this company around. There's no doubt I want to hire you. But because you're a pastor, He said, our company, because, you know, there were some gay people working there, and he had had a bad experience with the church, and, you know, he said, I can't hire you. He said, I can't hire you. And I sat in a bar,
In a bar, yes, sir.
And I preached the grace message to him with no Bible. Line upon line, scripture upon scripture, the grace message. And his eyes became open to who Christ was and who I was. Anyway, he ended up hiring me. But the point was, in that bar, he told me the story of him and his wife. Him and his wife would go to this community Catholic church. And they were there for several years. I mean, their little girls grew up in the church. And they went to the priest one day and they made a decision that, you know what, we want to get married. They were shacking up. And the priest looked at them and said, not only can we not marry you, we don't even know if we want you and your children in the church. Because you've been coming to this church this entire time, putting up this facade that you and your wife were married. So from that day to this day, they, until the time I ministered to them, they totally walked away from God. I believe had CJ and Florencia been in any other church under any other, well, not any other church, other churches, that young lady may have never received Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior because of what some preacher, what some law, some preacher would have tried to force her down. So we need to think about, what I'm saying is when we're dealing with our young adults, Anyway, when we're dealing with whoever we're dealing with, we need to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit is saying, how the Holy Spirit is doing what he's doing. You follow me? Because you can use every opportunity to get somebody born again and saved. And we got to understand what that means. It means a lot when somebody gives their life to Christ. It's a big thing. It's not a little thing. Amen?
Amen.
So that's what I wanted to go to tonight, and I want to talk about for the next 30 minutes, strife and the cutworm, because in churches today, there's a lot of strife going on. And I think that the reason why there's so much strife going on in church, Miss Carolyn, is we lose focus of why we're here. We're not here to be in leadership. We're not here to sing our solo. We're not here to be the pastor. We're not here to be the apostle, the prophet. We're not here for all those things. We're not here to prove that we're the best at this or we're the best at that. We are here to build a godly community to where people can come to church to be trained, to be developed, to be grown up in the selfless love of God, to have a lasting effect on their lives. That's really what we're here for. So then they can take that and they can go out into the world with that. The single biggest hindrance today to building a community of love and selflessness in our local church is strife and the cutworm. It breeds, strife and a cutworm breeds the ultimate turmoil in the church community. It breeds the ultimate turmoil. Strife is defined as this. It's a strong and ongoing conflict over a fundamental issue. Strife is deeper than an argument and broader than disagreement. Strife is deeper than an argument and broader than disagreement. Strife usually involves bitterness. It sometimes even leads to violence. We see strife today often in the political realm. We see it with candidates that take violent, you know, attacks on each other. I never understood how they get up there and talk about their wives, their kids, and all that, and then I'm going to vote for, you know, Biden's just on the stage talking about Kamala is this and that. How you say it? Kamala is this and that. And then 2 weeks later, that's my vice president. Or Trump's on the stage saying Pence this and Pence that, and two months later, he's my vice president. I don't get all that. I mean, there's some things you can say to me, but then there's some things you can't say to me. You can talk about me all you want. You can't talk about Pastor Franny and just think I'm going to sweep it under the rug. I might sweep you under the rug when I get done with you. Amen? So strife within families, that's another one, right? And that can result from lifelong emotional scars. You know, you have strife in the family because of what Uncle Pookie did to you many, many, many years ago. You know, he called you out your name many, many years ago. And now he's an older man now. Now you at the old folks home popping him upside the head because of what he did. Oh, we see this all the time. Parents get old, you know. Let me tell y'all, I done told my kids, if my wife goes before me and I got to go into an assisted living facility, I'm going to have a camera. See, because I already know what that one right there is going to do. Yeah, you're going to come in and pull my toes. I already know it. No. I'll be at home sleeping, minding my own business, and she'll come and pull my toe. And you ain't going to pull my toes when I get older. See, she thinks she's going to get even with me, right? Strife, right? Long-term emotional scars. We can have strife between nations. Amen? But this is what you need to write down. When it comes to strife, or when strife occurs among believers, in the church community, the church's testimony is tarnished, and Christ is dishonored. I need you to understand that. I need you. If you're a person that's got to have your way, listen to me. Say, Pastor loves me. I do. Sometimes y'all think I preach this stuff. You know, Ashley sent me a text today, and she called me her cut man. I like that. You're my corner man, Pastor. Thank you for being my cut man. You know, right? That is the greatest vivid description of what a pastor really should be, your corner man, your cut man, right? Because you're going to get cut up. But if you're the one that gets cut up and then you want to pick your ball up and go home every time that the pastor don't do what you want to do, well, I'll show Pastor Nick. Maybe he ain't looked at the tithe record lately. I'm the biggest tither in the church. I'll just stop tithing. We'll see how he likes that. Say strife in the community. When strife occurs among believers, the church's testimony is tarnished and Christ is dishonored. Christ is dishonored. When you call strife in the praise team, when you call strife in Ministry of Helps, when you cause strife among the church leaders, you're in leadership, and you're always causing strife, always, because you got to have your way. You don't understand what servanthood means. Can I say this to everybody tonight so nobody can say I'm talking about them? It doesn't matter what you want to do. It doesn't matter how you want to do it. It doesn't matter when you want to do it. And if it does, then that is not serving God. That's serving you. It's that simple, folks. It does not matter. Are you understanding me? I had a contractor today on a call with me. A contractor is somebody that a company, like I don't have enough work for a full-time Salesforce admin. So I pay a contractor that does Salesforce work to work for me. It's like her business. Right. She's working for me. Right. And this girl, we're on a call today with my leaders and the people from Salesforce. And she showed her behind. Right, Fran? You were listening, right? Fran was listening to the conference call. I mean, when we hung the phone up, I got an email from my VP of account. I know you're not going to let her talk to you. I said, oh, no, 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 no. You don't have to worry. You don't have to worry about that. She's going to show, I'm paying her. Now, this is like your gardener that you're paying to cut your property and maintain your, you got a group of people there to talk about the project you're going to do, and he's going to show his behind about what he's going to do and how, y'all understand what I'm saying? So what I'm trying to tell y'all is there are people like this in the church. And let me say this. Some of you do these things and don't even recognize it. And here's the problem with the church. When the church has such weak leadership that they won't take you aside and have a talk with you about, hey, you're bringing turmoil to the community. You got to let people know. You got to tell them, because sometimes they don't know it. And let me tell you, in the future now, when somebody says, hey, you're causing a little turmoil, don't get it. See, even that. Well, let me say, since I'm causing so much turmoil, let me just go home. Let me just find another church. No, that's not the answer. The answer is, can you give me an example of how I'm doing this? Because I obviously don't see it, and I want to know. You understand? I had the greatest thing happen the other day. I almost cried. It was so beautiful. There was a little situation that happened in the kids ministry, and it was Natifa, my wife, and Miss Alta. And Miss Alta picked up on it, and it was something that Natifa didn't see. This is not turmoil. Nothing. This is protocol. But so Miss Alta took Natifa aside, leader, right? She took Natifa aside and said, "Hey, you might want to buy." And Miss Alta did it the way Miss Alta does it. Right? Which is, Miss Alta can, you know, Miss Alta could get you to eat a rotten rat sitting on the top of the table. Because she just smiles and say, you know, that's just, it tastes so good, I'm telling you. Trust me. You know. But anyway, she had a great talk with, and Natifa picked up the telephone and she called her pastor because she don't want to bring turmoil to the community and she loves her pastor and she don't want to give offense or anything, any kind of opportunity, and called her pastor and said, hey, this and this happened. How could have I done that differently? How could have I not did what she did, she felt that was wrong? And she listened and they talked and she just cut that thing right off at the head. Amen. Give God some praise. Amen. That's how these things are supposed to happen. We're not supposed to keep going and going and going and going to have our way. That's what it's all about. The Bible warns against strife and it reproves those who cause it. Reproves those who cause it. It is to one's honor to avoid strife. We honor God when we avoid strife. Strife starts with gossip. Strife starts with gossip. Put Proverbs 20, verse 3 in the Amplified. Proverbs 20, verse 3 in the Amplified. It is an honor for a man to cease from strife and keep aloof from it. But every fool will what? Quarrel. What does that word quarrel mean? Argue about stupid stuff. Argue about stupid stuff. It is an honor for a man to cease from strife. We have to fight the compulsion to want to bring strife to the community. We have to fight the compulsion to John just walked in, to hold court. We got to fight that. I told you all this many times. It's the best terminology I ever heard one of our ex-managers, Matt Cardenas, about keeping strife up. You're holding court. You back there, we're outside on the balcony talking about his behind. And he's the manager. We shouldn't be doing it. Now, we didn't do that. We like that. And anything that we did talk about, we were talking about just try, because it was us. Well, it was actually Matt and John, and then they brought me into the team, but it was their thing. You know, it was us against the world, because this company had all these other successful offices. We were all the West Tampa boys. So y'all know we can't go down like that. We had to, you know, we had to let them all know what's up, right? So, but strife, this arguing, this gossiping, this talking, put up Proverbs 22 and 10. Amplified. These are all in the Amplified. Proverbs 22 and 10. Drive out the scoffer. See that? Uh-huh. And contention will go out. Yes, strife and abuse will what? Cease. Drive out the scoffer. Joyce Myers has one rule about ministry. There's one thing they don't tolerate. They do not tolerate strife in their ministry. They don't tolerate strife. They don't tolerate gossipers. They don't tolerate holding court. Period. She'll tell you that. They will put you, that's the one reason they will put you out of the ministry. If you bring strife, if you bring turmoil to the community, they don't play that. You can't get along with people. You need to figure out how to get along or you will leave. Y'all can tell me she's wrong or whatever. She's obviously doing a much better job than I am. Maybe I need to learn a little lesson from her. Amen? I'm just telling her. Don't get quiet on me now. Go to, I'll show it to you where strife cropped up even in the early church. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm gonna 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Let's read it in the Amplified Bible. I'm going to start in verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm going to read it in the Amplified. He says this, however, brethren, I could not talk to you as spiritual men, but as non-spiritual men of the flesh, in whom the carnal nature, what's that word? Predominates. As to mere infants in the new life in Christ, unable to talk yet. He said, I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not yet strong enough to be ready for it. But even yet, you are not strong enough to be ready for it. Let me tell you something. You want to identify where you're at spiritually? Y'all want to know how to identify spiritual people? People that gossip. Listen to me. People that talk about other people. Now, let me tell you, they do it in code. Man, wasn't that, what? Isn't Tifa's new hairdo beautiful? Oh, yeah. Oh, that's code. Oh, that's the code. It's code. She really don't like something about Latifah's hair. And what she's doing, she's teeing you up. Well, I don't know. I kind of didn't like it. It was the wrong color. It didn't. Yeah, that's what I, you know, I kind of thought that too. And now she jumps right in. Am I lying? Am I preaching to myself? It's just how we do it. Listen, don't let the offense thing go up. Listen to that. We all have done this. Ain't nobody in here innocent. Say, blood's on everybody's hands. This is for, say, it's for all of us to get better. I'm just trying to alert you. I'm trying to give you some high pitch tone so you know moving forward. We're going to teach on this every year because we need to keep it out the church. He said, I fed you with milk, not solid food, but you were not yet strong enough to be ready for it. But even yet, you were not strong enough to be ready for it. Watch this, verse 3. Here we go. For you are still unspiritual, having the nature of the flesh, under the control of ordinary impulses. Say gossip. Say jealousy, hatred, envy, He says, for as long as there are envy and jealousy and wrangling and factions amongst you, you are not, watch this, you are not unspiritual. You are not unspiritual and of the flesh, behaving yourselves as a human standard, and watch this, like mere unchanged men. So he's saying to you right here, right? This is what's going on. This is Paul talking to the church, saying we're still dealing with it in the church. 2,000 years later. People talking, impulses, jealousy, rank. Well, you know, I sing better than Pastor Franny. Why ain't I leading? He's the best one they got. Tifa's the best one they got. I sing better than her. Why can't I sing? Y'all with me? I can run the board better than David. Why ain't I running the board? Because we can't count on you to show up to run the board. You might be better than David. You might sing better than Tifa. You might be better than Pastor Franny. But God is not interested in your ability. He's interested in your availability. Amen? So we see here this goes on in the church. And we see that strife, the cause of strife, or the underlying cause is sin, right? What is causing the quarreling and the fighting amongst you, right? Don't they come from evil desire? I mean, think about how it works. It's always generally, think about, let's get out of the church for a minute. Let's go in your bedroom. Let's go to your house. You know, you want to have your way. Your wife wants to have her way. Y'all with me?
Yes, sir.
But there's got to be a medium way.
Yes, sir.
Y'all understand?
Yes, sir.
There's got to be some, it can't always be, you know, I just love my wife. She's just so awesome. She does everything you ask her to do. She don't never push back. She just does. Is that real love? You love somebody now because they do everything you want them to do when they want. Is that, I'm asking a question. Is that real love? I don't think that's real love. You want me to tell you why, Chip? Because you can only give in for so long. It can only be one-sided for so long, right? Because then ultimately, you get tired of giving in. Because you're giving in to see, can we come to a middle ground?
Yes, sir.
And I'm willing to be the adult. But that only lasts for so long, too. And then you end up blowing up, and now you feel like you're all the way back to square one. That's why it's not even good to always be the one giving up. And you know why? Does anybody know why we give up? Why we let the others in marriage? Why we let the other one have their way? Anybody know why? Y'all want me to tell you why? Because you don't want to deal with it. It's better to just do it than to deal to hear her mouth. or his mouth. It's always easier, right? Just give them what they want, right? You know, John has 19 TVs in his room. Oh, yeah. How many you got now, John?
Well, now I've got one big one, but it's got a bunch of little screens in it.
Oh. Poor Miss Brenda used to have earphones for her little TV over here. And John had 9 other TVs, and he's, talk about giving in. See? Now he's got one TV with 9 picture-in-picture screens. Do you know, John, I found out a fun fact today. You want to hear a fun fact? The last time the Dallas Cowboys were relevant, big screen TVs didn't exist. Wow. Wow. If you're a Cowboy fan, you hurting. Amen. I had to get that. It's football season, folks. They're coming. All right, so let's talk real quick. We only got a few minutes left. Let's talk real quick about the cutworm, okay? So I want you to understand something about the cutworm. Here's why the cutworm is worse than the person that brings strife to the community. You know why the cutworm is worse, Miss Emerson? Why do you think the cutworm is worse than a person that brings strife to the community? Huh? Oh, that's a good one. That's not it, but that's a good. The cutworm's underhanded, she said. See, the cutworm, the person who's bringing strife to the community, they're individually. The cutworm's desire is to take down the community. See, the cutworm goes underneath the ground and they cut out the roots and then the tree falls over. They want to bring down the whole tree. They're offended. They're hurt. Well, I'm going to show them. I've watched cutworms in marriages. Think about some of these young athletes that marry these hoochies. And then they go and tell a lie. Because they know they lie and the police come, the NFL's gonna get rid of them. And they literally lie on these young men that worked their whole life to get to this point. But guess what? If you ain't gonna be with me, baby, it ain't gonna be. And they take these men down. Think about that. That's worse than worse. Think about it in the church, man, when you have people that want to see your ministry do bad because they can't have their way. Here's the interesting thing about the cutworm. Y'all want a little bit more information on the cutworm? The cutworm, watch this, is a night feeder. The cutworm is underground, Jay, but he don't do his work till nighttime. Isn't that interesting? Who was the cutworm in the 12 disciples? Judas. You know when Judas did his work? He slipped around at night. And he gathered and he talked and he coerced and he schemed and he planned. Think about that for a minute. You think this is like just coincidental? The cutworm is so concerned to have their way. They'd rather everything die than them not get their way. See, you start off in strife and you end up being a cutworm. It starts off with strife, but it ends up being a cutworm. Does anybody know what was the exact point? Raise your hand. What was the exact point that Judas made the decision, that Judas got so offended? What happened that Judas got so offended with Jesus that he became this cutworm? Anybody know? Raise your hand. Yes, Amory. When the woman with the hair took the alabaster bottle of oil worth about $35,000 today and washed Jesus' feet with it. Watch this, y'all ready? We're gonna bring it to the church now. Judas questioned the pastor. Not asked the pastor a question. He didn't say, hey, I understand we're gonna wash your feet with all this stuff. Help me understand the dynamics of that, right? He didn't ask you the way John would ask you. John's going to make it sound, he's going to hook it up, right? No, that's not what he did. He said it like this. Whoa. What in the world are we doing putting this oil, using this for Jesus' feet? And y'all think, and listen, he wasn't worried about the poor. He talking about, we got to take care of the poor. Man, homeboy's worried about his pocketbook. Y'all got to understand, Judas kept the bank account. Judas was in the back counting the money. I tell Miss Alta, don't worry about counting the money. I'm going to count the money today. Miss Alta said, whoa. Why are you going to count the money? I want to count the money. Because she done planned what she was going to take before Sunday started. Y'all with me? So now she's offended. Hold on. She's driving home. Why is Pastor taking the money? I thought he said he would never do that. Now he's doing it. We need to say something about it. See what I mean? Here's why Judas had no business worrying about that. First of all, it wasn't his money. He was part of the ministry, but it wasn't his ministry. There's only one person who's responsible for that money. Jesus. There's only two people that are responsible for the money this church takes in. Me and my wife. That's it. There's only two people that got to answer for it. Well, and whoever Miss Alton is over finance, so she's responsible too. She's in it too. She's right with us. And whoever's back there with them, they're in it too. Oh, don't think I'm laughing now, but Benny Hinn had some folks in the back hooking it up. Oh, yeah, his director of finance, man, they were doing one for me, one for you thing going on all the time. Back in them days, they took up big cash money. They ain't too much cash to steal no more, is there, Miss Alton? I mean, we don't get very much cash, right? I mean, she might take $22, I don't know, right? What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying he got offended with what Jesus thought he... Who else died in offense? John the Baptist died in offense. Why? Because Jesus wasn't doing what he thought he should be doing. You get offended because your ministry head... It don't just have to be the pastor. See, because when you get offended with Leroy, you think you're offended with Leroy. First of all, you're not really offended with Leroy. You're offended with Pastor that he put Leroy in that position. Leroy shouldn't even be in this position. What Pastor? I should be in that position. Right? Oh, I'm talking to y'all about church right now. Amen. This is church. Think about it. What else do we get offended? Who Jesus appointed as head? Who Jesus decided to lead praise and worship? Who Jesus picked the Lakeisha could come up and receive the offering. Now, well, I believe I can receive the offering better than her. Amen. Why is she the one up there? Yes, how come Pastor ain't used me yet? Yep. These are all the things that get you offended, that start strife. You go from strife to being the cutworm. Are y'all listening to me? Yes, sir. I'm just trying to help you. And the only way you ever get over this is you come to the realization of two things. Number one, strife is dishonoring to God. That's the most important thing. Not Pastor Nick. You're not going to allow strife because you will not dishonor God. Are y'all with me? You don't bring turmoil to your community. You don't do it. You figure out a way for you to get over it. Don't wait for them to get over it. I didn't wait for Elder Nick to figure out how to get over and be nice to me. Now, I'm going to be real honest with you. Can I be transparent with y'all? Sometimes I get in trouble for this, but I'm going to be real transparent. I didn't get over that with Elder Nick because I love God. I didn't. I wasn't even thinking about that, Miss Mills. I got over that because I love my pastor. And I wouldn't do anything to bring turmoil to what God had called him to build. Because what God called him to do was transforming my life. And I'd do anything I had to do to protect that. I wouldn't allow it. I wouldn't allow it. I tell people all the time, I've never... You understand how long I've been connected to this church? I've been connected to Pastor Poe almost, how many years have been now? 20 or, nobody has ever come to me, Miss Mills, ever, ever. Man, you know, Pastor Poe ought to be, you know, he shouldn't be doing that. None of that kind of stuff. You understand me? I went down one morning and got the pastors and the deacons straight. How about that? I wasn't a director. I wasn't nobody. I was the sweep-up guy. My My wife called me and told me they were in the prayer room talking about my pastor. 5:30 in the morning, I was in my car on the Crosstown Express going about 110 in an Altima. Whee! That sucker was whining out. Whee! Ask my wife how fast I got. I went from Bloomingdale to Revealing Truth in about 21 minutes. Walked in, opened the door, looked at Pastor Cedric, looked at Marshall, and who was the other idiot? Yeah, I said, I need to see all three of y'all outside right now. Oh, yeah, right now. Need to see y'all outside right now. Sam, yeah. And we went outside, and I let them know. I said, let me tell y'all something. I said, y'all can say whatever y'all want about Pastor Poe. At 10 o'clock this morning when he gets here, we will all meet here, and everything y'all had to say this morning, we will sit in front of him and we'll talk about it. You can have any opinion you want if you want to talk about it in front of him. I said, but I'm going to tell you one thing. There ain't going to be no more talking about him when he ain't present. Am I clear? Oh, yeah, that's what I asked him. And Pastor Cedric, I'll never forget it, man, started crying, broke down, repented. The pastor said, repented to everybody. He ran Pastor Poe's soul-winning team. And I sent the other two back in. I looked at Pastor Cedric. I said, Pastor Cedric, you're a great man of God. Don't ever let people. See, even a great man of God could be influenced. See, you get around people that they're influenced. Man, you know, I don't know, man, if we really need to do it that way. I don't know if I agree with Pastor. People start talking like that. No, you just need to shut that down. Well, you know, since you don't agree with Pastor, let's just get them on the phone real quick. Hold on one second. Let me text them. Since you don't agree. Are y'all with me?
Yes, sir.
It ain't about nobody being right or wrong. It's about not letting your heart get polluted. Not letting yourself think that you're somebody or in some position that you're not. And it's not just about me and my wife. It's about if you're serving in a ministry. You don't do that against the person. The person that's over that Dean is head of ministry of us because I put him there. You got a problem with it? Come and see me. Don't take it out on Dean.
Amen.
He didn't ask for it.
Amen.
You think he asked to come and spend every one of his Saturday mornings here at the church cleaning y'all's church?
Amen.
Go to Titus chapter 3, verse 9. Titus chapter 3, verse 9. Y'all all right? I'm just telling you, man, the enemy just always wants to try to mess us up, man. He stinks. I don't like him. And then it causes problems amongst us, and then we start disliking each other for no reason. Just reasons that we don't have no reason to dislike somebody. And we just start disliking people for just no reason. But you know, Jennifer ain't talked to me since she's been at the church, man. How about you? Has she talked? She must think she's better than us. You know, stuff like that. Just need to shut it down. Now, understand something, folks. I'm trying to tell y'all something. Listen to Pastor Karen, people ain't going to be that direct in this church. See, here they got to come undercover. They got to be real careful. And they're going to tiptoe. And they're going to just throw you a little. You know, like when you're trying to get the bird first, you don't want to waste all your food. You throw just a little piece. And you just see it. They walk to it. Right? So they're not going to just come out and try you like that. Some churches will. They'll do that. They're not going to do that. But they'll slowly try you. You got to let them know where you stand. Remember something, folks. Don't ever forget this. It's going to hurt some people's feelings. People only take trash to the dumpster.
Amen.
If the trash is always finding its way to your doorstep, maybe you're a dumpster. Don't be a dumpster. And don't allow anybody to illegally dump trash in your dumpster. And I'm going to tell, can I tell y'all something truthfully? If you really check somebody, like really check them, they not only will stop doing that to you, they'll stop doing it, period. If you're really strong, you let them gossip. And when they get done, you look at them and go, you know what? I got to tell you, I got a lot of love for you, so I'm going to pray for you. But, man, you should really, really go back and consider what you just said. Because you really should feel kind of ashamed of yourself for thinking that way and most of all for talking that way. And whatever you do, I'm going to go pray about how to deal with this and how to handle it and let the Holy Spirit guide me on it. But don't ever come to me with that again. Ever. I promise you. I promise you. When they know they missed you like that, they won't. See, but if you're worried about the friend they are, you know, I don't want to lose my friends. See, that's what's wrong with a lot of y'all. Y'all think people are your friends. People that sit around and gossip is a friend you don't need. People that sit around and gossip are very, very insecure. You don't ever want to be around insecure people. Those are the people that will put your business all over the streets. Those are the people that will use all the information that you give them to lift themselves up. Those are the people that will, I promise you, those are the people that get you called into the principal's office. Right? Titus chapter 3, verse 9 to 11 in the Amplified. Titus chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. It says, but avoid stupid. See, I had to show you all these words are in the Bible. I don't just make them up. But avoid stupid and foolish, what? See that? And genealogies and dissensions and wranglings about the law. For they are what? Unprofitable and futile. You see that? Futile. As for a man who is factious, oh yeah. A what? Come on, where are all my teachers at? Help a brother out. Heretical centurion. And causer and cause of divisions. Person that causes strife. After admonishing him a first and a second time. Here's where Joyce Myers got this from. Reject him from your fellowship and have nothing more to do with him. Do y'all see that? Have nothing more to do with him. That is in the New Testament, right?
Yes, sir.
That is after the grace message, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm just checking. It says, verse 11, well aware that such a person has utterly changed, is perverted and corrupt. He goes on sinning, though he is convicted of guilt and self-condemned. So this is these people that we're talking about. Amen? Path that we should pray for everybody. No, there's some people need to be put on check. Because let me tell you what, it ain't gonna help them. It don't help them. And it don't help the community. It don't help the church. But what I'm trying to tell y'all, we don't have to go through a lot of that. If everybody comes together and understands what strife sounds like, feels like, I'm talking about when y'all are at home. Y'all gotta stop it at home. Somebody's gotta step up. Now, we ain't going to do that. We ain't going to sit around here and talk about Harry. We're not going to do that. I love me some Harry. Leave Harry alone. Let's talk about Jay. Right?
Yes, sir.
So I want to keep on this on Sunday, but here's what I want you to, on Sunday, I want to talk about. Number one, God hates strife in the community, and he hates it for several reasons. But the one I want to leave you with tonight before we take some questions about strife is strife destroys unity. A cutworm's job is to destroy unity. Unity based on the truth of God is so important that Jesus... It's so important to Jesus that in his longest prayer, he asked the Father that his followers be one as you and I are one. John 17, 22. Be one as you and I are one. Anything that shatters, impedes upon, jeopardizes the unity of the church is an enemy of God. Is an enemy of God. Don't be an enemy of God. Don't be an enemy of God. It's that simple. What you want, the way you see it, watch this. The way you feel about it is not worth being an enemy of God. It's just not worth it. You may not agree with it. But you know, I sit Harry down. You know, Harry's a nice guy, Pastor. Harry's always Miss Mills. Pastor, what's you man? Harry's a nice young man, Pastor. You now she could come to me and say, you know, Harry's a nice young man, you know, but you, hey, Pastor, you shouldn't have sat Harry down. I don't agree with that. Hold on, whoa. What do you mean? That's my role. That's not your role. Yeah, you could, like I said, you can come to me and, hey, you know, Harry's, and then I'll tell you, you know what you need to do? You need to go talk to Harry. Let Harry tell you why he got sat down. Because maybe you don't know what happened in the booth in the back in the corner in the dark that got him sat down. Now, what I like, what Pastor Dollar used to do, Mr. Mills, is when he would sit somebody down, he'd bring the leaders up before the church, and he'd tell the whole church what the leaders did. If the leader, see, he'd give you a chance. Now, you have done something that is bad enough, I need to put you out of the church. But I'm going to give you grace. But you ain't going to slip around in the cut. So if you want that grace, you're going to need to prove that you want it, because we're going to bring you up before the whole church, and you're going to tell the whole church what you did. Oh, go. Y'all need to go listen to a podcast, Pastor Wante and Pastor Ezel. Oh, yeah. Pastor Wante and Pastor Ezel went against something Pastor Dollar told them to do. Pastor Dollar sat them down for a year, brought them up before the whole church. Say, where much is given, much is required. Well, I thank God for Pastor Dollar and everything he did. That's why he's got the church he has today. Because he did not compromise the word for nobody. Now, we're talking about leaders now. We're not talking about babes in Christ. We're not talking about the people that need the milk. You can't do that to everybody. Everybody's not ready for that. You understand me? Pastor Dollar sat Pastor Poe one time down for 90 days, never told him why, just to see what he'd do. Amen. Think about that, Chip. This man moved his job. Pastor Dollar said from the pulpit that the church was in need of a full-time minister. Pastor Poe was working in the 7-Eleven from 7 in the morning till 3. He told him he wanted to move his schedule from 7 in the morning till 3 to the night shift. Moved his job to the night shift, showed up the next Monday, Paula, at the church with his briefcase and his tie on at 9 o'clock in the morning. He said, Pastor, I'm here. I'm ready to go. Pastor Dollar looked at him and said, well, we can't afford a full-time minister. I was speaking faith, you know, we're gonna have. He said, oh, no, you don't have to pay me. I'm here to serve. I'm here to. He worked for 3 years for the church as a full-time minister for free, not a penny, and changed his job. And while he was working for the church for free, Pastor Dollar sat him down for 90 days in front of the whole church. Told him for the next 90 days, all you're to do, you're to show up at every service, you and your wife, you're to sit in those two seats. They had two seats they had to sit in. You're not to do anything except carry my Bibles and my water up to the pulpit, go sit down, get the word. When I'm done, come back up, get my Bible. This is where the whole PPA thing started at World Changers. The whole armor bearer, all that. You see all these books about now? This is where it all started. You are to serve me. That's what he told him. For 90 days. Y'all see these pastors that y'all think they're doing all these great, and y'all, everybody thinks this is just these women and men of God have been through some stuff. Yeah. You look at Joyce Meyer's story. You look at some of these great, I'm talking about these people that got great anointings on their lives. The Bible says where much is given, much is required. But every time we got to go through just a little something, to where we can't have our way or how we think it should be or whatever, man, we pack our stuff up and go home. Amen. Y'all understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. All
right. Y'all get anything out of the word tonight?
Amen.
Y'all like, Pastor, it was your birthday, man. You happy? I mean, first of all, I do want to tell everybody, thank you so much for all the calls, the texts, the Facebook posts, the money, the gifts, the, man, y'all just did me good, man, made me happy. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Everybody, I'm just so thankful. Let's take some questions. We got time? I want to let you out a little bit early because I know the kids got school tomorrow. Any questions tonight before we wrap up? All right. Hallelujah. We got some questions. Miss Brenda.
It's a simple question. Would you say that strife is inviting the devil in your house?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's
church?
Yeah, so we said strife is the way the Bible defined it. It's an enemy of God. Because God is unity. God is love. God is oneness. God is togetherness. So anything that comes against that. That's why. So, see, the only way we can get over this, not be partakers of it, you got to have that dog whistle. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to have that thing that. I remember one time we were in a men's meeting, and Pastor was talking about sexual lust with men and how you, and he talked about this thing where there was this trumpet, and he yells real loud. He plays his trumpet. He says, you know what you do when you get in that situation, men? You run! And he yelled like that. And I could remember times when I was traveling, if my mind even just, I could just hear him. I could hear him yelling, man, I just kind of walked the other way. You know what I mean? So you got to have things that like this message, the reason why we're going to teach this today and tomorrow, maybe another, is because you got to get your awareness up. When people, because the people, you got to remember too, now here's another thing. The people that are doing it aren't bad people. They're just people that allow themselves to be used by the enemy. They're not willfully allowed. When your kids bring turmoil to your home,
right.
Joey and Sophia ever brought turmoil to the home?
Oh, what day?
You think they're devils?
No,
they're not devils. It's the enemy knows that this person can't bother you or John, or this person can't make y'all take your peace away.
Right.
But if they can get to your kid, your kid can really, really, right, Keisha? I mean, Tifa, really challenge your peace.
Yes. Would you say that when there is strife and you're da-da-da-da-da, then you give the enemy ammunition?
God, shut it down.
We just told him what is, and so he sends his little minions to really disrupt.
Right. You know, people ask me all the time, Brenda, like especially in the church. Well, you know what, Pastor, if we can't discuss it and we have a problem with you, then what do we, well, you got a problem with me, come and talk to me. That's what you can do. You can come, well, you know, oh, no, then you need to shut up. Mm-hmm. If you're scared, right? I mean, if you want to talk to me, just come and talk to me. Have I ever bitten any of y'all? You know, like physically bitten? I don't bite. I really don't. Next question. Thank you, Miss Brenda. Come on, let's go. I know y'all got some questions about this. Ain't nobody got no questions. Y'all gonna make me do questions on Sunday? Because we know Randy's got one. That's my go-to man. That's all right. Amen.
Question is, how do you deal with strife within yourself? Like, you have strife against yourself.
Explain to me how that looks. When you say strife against yourself, what do you feel that you do that's strife against yourself?
Mostly like negative talk.
Oh, okay. Negative talk against yourself. That's, I don't know, that's really strife against yourself. You're just at a place where you need to renew your mind, right? You need to renew your mind, and you need to, remember what I said on Sunday, I don't know if you were here on Sunday, identify what it is that's that challenge. Like Sunday we were talking about fear, if there's an area that you fear, and then we'll write it out, and we'll get you some scriptures around it, Okay. Any questions online? No, no, nobody online wants any. Okay. All right. I love you guys.
Love you back.
Amen. Thank y'all all. Again, amen. Yeah. Oh, we got a question? Oh, I had a great birthday. I did. Really enjoyed it. My wife took me down to Fort Lauderdale Beach, so we spent a little time down there. Had a great breakfast this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, when you have a $140 breakfast, that's pretty good, right? Right, for breakfast? I mean, that used to be like a nice dinner, right?
Yeah.
I'm like, man, what in the world is going on? No, I had everything. Went to the Four Seasons and had everything. Yeah, that could get a little bit expensive. But anyway, it was good. They have a different spin on lox and bagels. Yeah, they make their own bagel, and they make a straight bagel like this, and they put the cream cheese on top, and they put it, it's delicious. Really good. Anyway, amen. Hallelujah. Fort Lauderdale Beach. You know where that's at, right? All right. No other questions. Y'all sure? Man, that was pretty. Tiba has one. Go ahead. I'll repeat it. Go ahead. Right. Can it bring about something better happening? So she's asking, so Judas brought strife, but it kicked off Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. So if you do have strife and you get through it, or it you work through it, can it be the kickoff of something better? Listen, let me say this to that. There's nothing greater than when somebody's in offense, when somebody's been hurt, when strife has been in a place. Repentance and true forgiveness absolutely kicks off greater things. Because it goes back to what I tell y'all all the time. We have to go through some things to get to a certain point to know what you got, right? And that's the key. So, yes, every time you overcome a major situation where strife was there and then you overcome it, that's a great thing. That's a great thing. Yeah, so it can always be. All right? Any others? Amen. Well, give God some praise. We're going to have Keisha come up and receive our offering. Again, I just want to say one more time before I go, thank you all so much for all of your love, for all of your gifts, for all of your cards. You know, it's funny. Can I just talk about one of my gifts? Nobody get offended, but I'll talk about your gift.
Go ahead.
So Jerry brought me this card, and my wife and I were reading it on our way down to Fort Lauderdale, and it was a very simple scripture. But as I was reading it, I saw something in it that I've read the scripture a thousand times, probably at least a thousand times, and I saw something in it that I had never seen before. Just one scripture, wasn't no long, just one scripture. I see y'all. Well, tell me what you saw, Pastor. I'll tell you when the time is right. But, man, I saw something, and God showed it to me a different way. And I believe it was just because of the emotional state I was in when I was reading it and how I looked at it and how I saw it. I just saw it from a different lens. And it had nothing to do with the card that she brought me. It had nothing to do with the actual card. And it was interesting because it started through, I was looking at the uniqueness of her writing. Yeah, this happened with some things Elizabeth has given me, just the way that, I just like the little creative stuff people do, right? It's just kind of a thing with me. I'm not a creative. I admire. I am kind of a creative, but I admire creatives. I admire that side of the brain, right? But man, when I read this, so all that out the window, then I read this scripture. And it was the scripture about Jesus making disciples out of us. And it was a scripture that talked about, which one was it for? It talked about how God wants us to bear much fruit. God wants us to be successful in everything that we do. And the definition, if we are really walking with God, is that we are bearing much fruit. It was just powerful. It was so powerful to think, for those of you who don't think God keeps score. Amen. It goes to this thing about, you know, we can just do it any kind of way. I said it on Winning in the Word this morning. There's so much good that we could do in the world. There's so much good. But we have to get focused. We have to get strategic because we need to be producing. And being scattered, a lot of times you're not producing. Our ministry is going to get really dialed in going into 2024 and for the rest of this year. It's about us getting dialed. Man, we started a thing on Saturday with our leadership team, and we're going to continue it. And our leadership team is going to come together, and we're going to go, amen. We're going to go into 2024. Man, let me tell you something. We're going to go into 2024 strong. And if you want to be part of that leadership team, you need to let the leader of your ministry know. Because we are going to be developing some people, and we're going to make some noise in Orlando in 2024. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I love you guys.
Hallelujah. Well, let's give our pastor another hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. I don't know about you guys, but I have truly been enjoying this sermon series, The Brook and the Blessing. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. I mean, I tell you, I have a better awareness now, looking to give my husband the advantage, looking to give the advantage in my relationships. And the message that Pastor taught tonight, I mean, just think about it. I'm so grateful and thankful that we have pastors that's bold enough and courageous enough to give us the truth to talk about strife and the cutworm so we can get it right in our community and walk in love. Amen. Amen. Well, it's time to invest into God's kingdom. Give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. We're going to turn to Proverbs chapter 3 tonight. And you know, Pastor said on Sunday that God does not. Okay. Brother Leroy, go get Pastor for us really quickly. All right. We have something that we want to present to Pastor tonight, so we're gonna go bring him back in here. So now our tech team is getting ready. Okay, I'm gonna bring him back in here. You guys know today is his birthday. Hallelujah! So we want to celebrate him, do something nice and special for him before he leaves out. Hallelujah. So while we wait, have you guys been enjoying this sermon series? Yeah, it's a really awesome word tonight. Can't wait to re-listen to the message again. And you guys know that we have Fun Fest coming up. I think Fun Fest is in about, what, 30 days? 30 days. So, hey, if you guys know any cutworms, anybody that's in Strife, no, I'm serious. I think the Fun Fest is a great thing to invite them to because it's an event outside of the church. You know, many people today are offended with church or church hurt. It's a great event to invite them to because this event, like I said, is outside of the church. You guys know that we're all loving. Hallelujah. Let's give them a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. So we have something special that we want to present to you that Brother Leroy is actually going to present to you when he gets in here. So while we wait for Brother Leroy, Fun Fest, invite the cutworms. Invite the people that's in strife, because it's a great opportunity for them to experience the love of God outside of a church atmosphere. And I believe it'll bring them to a place of restoration.
And let me say that. If you have a friend, tell them it's free. Pay for them. Give them $10. If you need it, I'll give it to you. Let me know. We did the $10 thing because we want people signing up. We need to. The problem we have is we have a lot of people signing up and they don't show up. So our thinking is, well, we charge them $10, maybe they'll show up, right? That's really the reason. So, Lexi, if we need to pay for somebody, pay for them. It's $10, okay? Get them there. Amen?
All right. You want to tell them about the activities for the kids?
Oh, yeah. Listen, man, we have this really – I'm excited about this. My daughter, man, came up with this idea, and Jeremiah and her is just – we're going to have like a – is it 40 feet? Oh, we're going to have an 80-foot rock climbing wall. Yeah, and it, up to four kids can climb. Kai, it's 80 feet high. So we're going to have a rock climbing wall. Listen to this. We're going to have a gaming truck. So we're going to have a truck show up. How many gamers? 10 to 20 gamers. So we're going to have a full-out Call of Duty war going on, right? So we can go in there. It's air-conditioned. We're going to see if Jay still has any skills, right? You still got Call of Duty skills? Okay. Lyric, you got Call of Duty skills? Are we allowed to play Call of Duty, Pastor Brandon? Oh, we can? Okay. Anybody else play Call of Duty? All right. Anyway, we got a bunch of great games. We got barbecue. Y'all know we have the drawing. So we're gonna have a lot of fun stuff to draw from. I don't want to tell y'all yet everything, but you just need to tell them. There's definitely going to be some big TVs. TVs. See, I'm thinking like we start at 50 and we go up to 80. Maybe we give away like one TV, right? Y'all see Miss Brenda showed up today, my leaders. Y'all remember what I told y'all to do? Y'all need to get with Miss Brenda if somebody wants to and ask her how she got us all that free stuff. She'll coach y'all up. Miss Brenda's good, okay? But yeah, so we're going to give away some TVs. I think we're going to give away a gaming console for the kids. We got a bunch of, I think we're going to try to give away some vacations or spas day. We're going to give away a bunch of cool stuff, right? Maybe a little, am I supposed to stop? Anyway, we're going to have well over $5,000 worth of prizes that we're going to give away, man. We're going to have lots of gift certificates, gas cards, all that kind of stuff, okay? So that's one way to get them there, okay? Amen. All right, here, Leroy, you want this?
So we're continuing to celebrate your birthday, Pastor.
I see that.
And so I want to share one thing with the congregation. Come over. Okay. Share one thing with the congregation. And so you always talk about how you enjoyed the card from Jerry and then from Jay and Elizabeth. So gave Lakeisha an assignment. You know if you give her an assignment, she's going to come back with the answer. So Lakeisha created a way for us all to make a card, so to speak, and write you a note.
Oh, okay.
So we've done that for you, and we'll let you open this. We also included some of your brothers in the ministry.
Oh, okay.
And what I like to share with you guys is that, you know, we have a certain way that we think about Pastor and how he's our father and we honor him. I tell you that nothing moves me more than to talk to these men of God and ask them to participate. And they are out. I mean, they just get so excited, legitimately excited about it. What do you need for Pastor Nick? What do you need for Pastor Nick? They are just all over it. And they so reverence and
well,
so respect.
Just say, you know, a million each would be good.
That's next year for
so
your.
Excited.
That's next year for your 60th. So, but yeah, they really participate. They're really excited, and we want to give you this gift, just to try cap off everything that we've done this week, and we want you to open that.
Y'all know, I'm gonna open this, but y'all know y'all got me a. Y'all even got me a
picture
thing, too.
Yeah, you'll understand how it goes together.
Oh, it goes together.
How? So I'll do color commentary. What it is a book.
Okay, so I'm not going to open this now because I'll start crying.
Yes.
Look at save it for home?
Yeah.
Wow, look at that. Oh, man.
So it's a book, and it's got photos of us, and we've all written you notes. Aww. So collectively, you have a book of...
Oh, that's awesome, guys.
All right, let's give another hand clap of praise for our pastor on his birthday. Stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, you guys may be seated. We're doing the offering now. All right, opportunity time for prosperity. So turn to Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. We're going to go there tonight. You know, and Pastor said on Sunday that God does not need our experiences to perfect us. And I thought that was so liberating when he said that, you know, God doesn't need our experiences to take us to where he's trying to get us, but he needs our belief, he needs our faith, and he needs our trust. Amen. So I'm reading to you Proverbs 3, verse 5 in the New Living Translation. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take." Amen. So how this relates to our finances is God doesn't need our get-rich-quick schemes. He doesn't need our experiences to bring us to a place of prosperity, to take us to where he wants to get us. But what he needs is our trust. And he also says to do his will. And we know what God's will is concerning our finances. He says in Genesis that we're blessed to be a blessing and to all families of the earth have been blessed. And then looking at the New Testament, he says in Luke to give, and it shall be given unto us. And he says in 2 Corinthians that he loves a cheerful giver whose heart is in his giving. So we already know that it's God's will for the believer to give. Amen. And he says that when you do that, he's going to show you which path to take. Now, we all know that money doesn't fall out of the sky, right? I wish it does, but it don't. But what he's talking about is he's going to give us wisdom. He's going to give us those financial strategies to get ahead. And one of the blessings of being here at this Brook, we already have one of those financial strategies, right? Do you guys remember what it is? What is it? Yep, tithe 10, save 10, and learn to live off the 80. Amen. So when we sow our seed tonight, let's trust the Father. The Father knows what he's doing with our lives. It's a sign that we do trust him is that we don't lean to our own understanding. The Father got us. Amen. All right, I'm going to pray. Well, actually, sorry, if you need a tithe or an offering envelope, raise your hands. The ushers will serve you. Got one over here. All right, I'm going to go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight, Lord God. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving us seed to sow. We thank you, Lord God, that we can trust you, Lord God, with our lives, Father. We can trust you with our finances, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for the seed that we have tonight, Father. And we thank you, Father, for giving us wisdom, Lord God, on what to do with the harvest. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. The ushers are released to serve you. If you're giving online, go to ltmorlando.org/give. And I think we've already covered our announcements tonight. Remember Fun Fest. Make sure you guys sign up and register. $10 for adults, $5 for children. Invite the cutworms. Invite the people that's in offense. Well, invite, you know, of course, invite your family and friends, right? All right, has everyone had an opportunity to sow? Okay. All right. Are you adults excited about the wall that we're going to have, the rock climbing wall? Are some of you guys going to get on there as well? I better not see any of you fall on there. Be careful. Okay, cool beans. All right, everyone sold? All right, let's go ahead and stretch our hands to our seed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this seed tonight. I speak and command the blessing, Lord, over everyone who's sown, Father. I speak 2 Corinthians 9:7 over their lives, Father, that you have enabled us, Father, to give into every good work, Lord God, in charitable donation. We speak to this seed and repeat after me, say, go, grow, and we'll see you soon. With many friends, in Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Lift those holy hands, repeat after me, let the words of my mouth.
Hey there, thank you so much for joining us today. We genuinely hope that you enjoyed service, and most importantly, that you got something out of the word today that will transform your life forever. Now, before we go, we want to make sure that you have the opportunity to get saved today. No matter who you are or what you've done, it's not greater than what Jesus did for you when he died for you. He loves you and he wants you to start fresh today. So, if you've never been saved, if you've never asked Jesus to come into your heart, no worries. If you're ready, we can take care of that right now. Okay, we're going to read just 4 scriptures to get your place in heaven squared away today. Let's start at Romans 3:23. It says, namely, the righteousness of God, which comes by believing with personal trust and confident reliance on Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And it is meant for all who believe, for there is no distinction. Since all have sinned and are falling short of the honor and glory which God bestows and receives, basically, we've all missed it. No one is perfect, which is great, because if we were, we wouldn't need Jesus. Next, we'll go to Romans 6:23 that says, for the wages of sin is death, but the bountiful free gift of God is eternal life through, in union with, Jesus Christ our Lord. This salvation we're talking about is a gift. You don't have to work for it. It's here and ready for you. Now, for the good part. Romans 10:9-10 says, because if you acknowledge and confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and in your heart believe, adhere to, trust in, and rely on the truth that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Verse 10, for with the heart a person believes, adheres to, trusts in, and relies on Christ, and so is justified, declared righteous, acceptable to God. And with the mouth, he confesses, declares openly, and speaks out freely his faith and confirms his salvation. It's just that simple. Confess and believe. And now let's bring it all home to John 10:10. The thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. God has so much in store for you. And he wants you living the abundant life in every area of your life, in your health, relationships, money, joy, peace, everything. Are you ready to make it official? Lift your hands and repeat after me. Thank you, God. I thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for sending him to die for me. I am a sinner, but today I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Come into my heart, live in me, lead me, and guide my footsteps. Satan, I serve notice on you. You no longer have power over me. I belong to God, and through him, I will reign, rule, and dominate in the earth. As the word says, I will enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. Amen. That's it. Congratulations. Now, this salvation you just received comes with some pretty sweet benefits. I want you to go to ltmorlando.org/salvation and download the free resource. Or you can hit the button below the video if you're watching on our site. Again, go to ltmorlando.org/salvation or hit the button below the video. Well, that's it for today's service. If you're ever in the Orlando area, you're invited to join us in person at 6500 Weingard Road in Orlando, Florida. We're live online every Sunday at 11 a.m., Wednesdays at 7 p.m., and every weekday morning at 8 a.m. for just 15 minutes. Make sure you hit the like button and the notification bell so you get the alert every time we go live, or just find us on our website. On behalf of Pastor Nick, Pastor Franny, and the entire LTM family, we love you, we love you, we love you. And until next time, enjoy life.